First of all, I must begin by putting on record my deep appreciation to the organizers of this wonderful comprehensive activity on foundations of quantum physics that have been organized, comprising an extensive school and a conference, very interesting conference, and most importantly, with active participation. Can you hear me? Hello. Hello. So I must put on record my deep appreciation to the organizers of this wonderful comprehensive activity on quantum foundations that have been organized, comprising an extensive school and a very interesting conference. And it is really very satisfying to see a large number of young students, doctoral and postdoctoral, from different parts of the country as well as from abroad. Unfortunately, I missed the school going to my commitments at the institute. But those of us who had initiated this research area in this country, it is immensely satisfying to have such a large number of participants. And I again deeply thank the organizers for taking this activity, and surely we need to move such activities in the future. And so it is personally very satisfying for me to give the talk at this conference. Now, the topic of my today's talk concerns an issue which I believe has not been covered much in the school or in the conference. So that is the issue of macrorealism and the probing of macrorealism and its incompatibility with quantum mechanics. So I shall first explain why this study is important. This study was initiated many years ago in 1985, but has picked up only in recent years and has much future promise. So the fundamental quantum questions which are relevant to the theme of this talk. So let me first set the prelude of the talk. So to contrast this area of study with that concerning local realism, the central issue, one of the key issues addressed in this line of study is the testing of realist models of quantum mechanical behavior of single particles. While in the study concerning Bell's inequality and local realism, the attention is focused on spatially separated particles, and the study of the quantum compatibility with the realist models in that sort of context involving locality conditions. Here, instead of that, it is the issue of macrorealism which is involved, and it is the testing of realist models in a scenario where no entanglement is involved. No question of spatial separation between the particles. It is the temporally separated measurements on single particles. And a spin-off of this study is the testing of quantum mechanics in the macro limit, and also providing insight into the questions of how classicality emerge out of quantum mechanics and what sets the limits of observability of quantum effects. So there are two ways of looking at the significance of the study on macrorealism. One, to use the test of macrorealism as a signature of non-classicality in contexts where things are happen to believe in a classical way, or in a special, or for specially engineered systems where we don't yet, where we need to certify quantum behavior, which is also becoming important in quantum information transfer context and all those processes. And the other, research is that about to what extent one can constrain the realist models of quantum mechanics, what class of realist models of quantum mechanics can be empirically ruled out, in contrast to the local realist models being tested in the study concern. So the plan of the talk is that first I shall explain what the meaning of realism and the notion of local realism, just as it involves the notion of realism and locality. Here, the notion of macro realism involves the notion of realism and what is known as non-invasive measurability. instead of locally. So that is a crucial difference. So the role of measurement in quantum theory plays a significant direct role in this study, in contrast to that in Bell, in studies concerning local realism, non-locality, and so on. So in that sense, it complements the study concerning quantum non-locality in constraining various possible alternatives to quantum, as well as enabling methods for certifying non-classicality. Now, just as for local realism, we have different necessary conditions, the most widely used being the Bell or the Bell-CHS condition. But there are also other necessary conditions of local realism, which has been in recent years shown to be inequivalent to Bell, like I-3-3-2. But anyway, so similarly, in the study of macro realism also, there are different necessary conditions. Historically, this was the first necessary condition of macro realism proposed, and that initiated this whole line of study. That was in 1985, the paper by Leggett and Dar. But after that, there was not much activity, and only in the last 10 years, this area has picked up. And in recent years, two other necessary conditions of macro realism have been proposed. Now, I must emphasize that all these necessary conditions of macro realism, just as the necessary conditions of local realism, they are all derived from the same conjunction of assumptions, locality or realism. In that case here, realism and non-invasive measurability. So in that sense, one can say that they look a priori equivalent, but different consequences of local realism or macro realism. But it depends on the context in which this is applied. And also, it turns out that the robustness of these necessary conditions with respect to imprecision of measurements or white noise present in the state are different. That is also in the case of the study of local realism that has been also revealed in recent years. And as I have already stated, all these conditions are in terms of time-separated joint probabilities or correlation functions corresponding to successive measurements on a system, in contrast to that in the study of local realism, where the spatial separation. And in this talk, after some more prelude, where I will spend some time in explaining the basics of macro realism and these different necessary conditions, since no talk earlier has perhaps covered this issue. Then I will come to the main content of the talk, namely our two recent works. These two works illustrate two different aspects of the study of macro realism. This one illustrates the power of the study of macro realism in certifying non-classicality in contexts where, whether it is really classical or non-classical, there is considerable debate or uncertainty or different viewpoints. And that is the large spin system in uniform magnetic field, which is subjected to coarse-grained measurements. You already heard all those precision measurement talks and all those where it was emphasized that you see quantum effects. Important to see, fine-tune the precision of measurements. So theoretically, conceptually, this whole question of how classicality emerges out of quantum mechanics, you of course have the idea of decoherence, but apart from this dynamical idea of decoherence, there is also the idea of coarse-grained measurements, that the imprecise fuzzy measurements or coarse-grained measurements will also enable classicality to emerge out of quantum mechanics. So that idea historically was first suggested by Max Born, a celebrated exchange with Einstein, that Born-Einstein letters, because Einstein worried a lot about how classicality can emerge out of quantum mechanics. And Born made this suggestion, and later Michael Berry and others picked up on it. So in the context of those suggestions, the study of macro realism provides a powerful way of probing to what extent this idea holds. And I shall present our study in the context of large spin, present what our conclusions are. And the other study that I shall present in this work concerns where the study of macro realism can be used to explore the non-classicality in the mass range of 10 to the power 6 to 10 to the power 9 AMU for recently studied technology, the recently developing technology of oscillating nano objects. I will come to this in more detail when I discuss Now, macro realism, as I've already said, and realism, now it is important to realize that, right, like in local realism, where you use the notion of realism, it is defined in a most general way, that an object, external reality system exists independent of whether you measure or not, and has definite properties, irrespective of measurement. So the objects have definite values of their observable properties. Here, in the notion of realism, the way it is used in macro reality, this is an important concept that the system is assumed to be in one of the available states. So it is assumed that a realist model that you are going to, in the context of which these assumptions are formulated, they define what a state is. Why I'm emphasizing this, because it is important to realize this way of testing. One is not ruling out all possible forms of realism. So there are some restrictions on the type of realist models considered in this exercise. Likewise, in the study of Bell's inequality, you have the restriction of locality and you restrict only local realism. So sometimes, very often, we have seen claims based on this type of studies that all realism is proved wrong in quantum mechanics. It's very common in the context of the Bell experiment. So one has to emphasize this feature again and again. So here, similarly, here in the study of macro realism, when you define realism, you define that a system, we mean by realism that if a system is available to it, one of the available states, the concept of state being defined in the model you are going to test, and all its observable properties have definite values corresponding to the definite state. If a realism, if any theory has this property, and that theory also allows that in principle, it is possible to determine which of the states the system is in without any effect on the subsequent dynamics or without affecting the state, revealing the pre-measured values of this property, then that model will be stated, will be taken to satisfy what is known as the notion of macro realism. Measurement. Observable means measured, all the measured properties. So the process of measurement in this, the class of realist models considered this way, have a concept of state and also have a concept of measurement. When I say have a concept of measurement, we mean it allows for how a measurement can be described. And that stipulates that the pre-measured value, the measurement reveals the value of the observed, of the dynamical property that existed before measurement. So you can minimize the disturbance. But how best to implement to satisfy this assumption, as I will shortly explain, this notion of negative result measurement is very crucial in this study, because you may say, okay, so this looks like a vague assumption to, as you say, in principle, to determine which of the system states the system is in. That means you can, it is of course assumed that in the classical theory, you can minimize the perturbation to the extent you like. Like if you measure the temperature of the water, its thermal properties are not significantly perturbed. So it seems like an imprecise concept, but it can be both. The notion of non-invasive measurability can be made more precise and definite and credible in the context of what is known as negative result measurement. So in order to use, to make the study of macro realism really meaningful, you need to satisfy this non-invasive measurability by implementing what is known as negative result measurement. This is the way I shall discuss, but there are also other ways of implementing it, non-invasive measurability. I'm not going into those in this talk. So likewise, in the Bell model also, Bell test, you have to satisfy the locality condition. There are certain conditions you have to satisfy the locality, like space-like separation, to what extent you can say. So, and this class, when I say that this class of realist models covered by this notion does not include, for example, Bohm's model. I will explain that shortly. So when you are violating a necessary condition of macro realism, so it is a tool for revealing non-classicality. And that I shall illustrate in the first example of my talk. And what is importantly, there also I'll compare the efficacy of the different necessary conditions, macrorealism. Because there may be experimental context where one of the necessary conditions is able to reveal non-classicality, but the other may not. So in that sense, all the availability of all these different necessary conditions have enlarged the scope of this study. And also, if you can violate a necessary condition of macrorealism by satisfying what is known as negative result measurement, by implementing it in an unambiguous way, then you can not only demonstrate non-classicality, but also can rule out those classical, those realist models that have been envisaged within the notion of macrorealism. So there is a dual significance if you can achieve unambiguous implementation of negative result measure. Now, these are the different necessary conditions that have been proposed for macrorealism. As I said, this was the first one. This was derived from the deterministic form of macrorealism, and then this one was derived from the probabilistic form of macrorealism. And this condition has been formulated as a statistical version of non-invasive measurability. And it was argued that since the violation of non-invasive measurability at the statistical level would naturally imply violation at the individual level, so this would imply violation of macrorealism. So this was also suggested as a possible necessary condition. I shall quickly illustrate what are these inequalities. Now, just to put things more concretely, if you consider, say, a temporal evolution of a two-state system where the available states are, say, 1 and 2, and you consider an observable Q which can take only value plus 1 or minus 1 if it is in state 1 or 2, then it is easy to verify that since independent of measurement in the notion of realism, it is assumed that these observables all have definite values, then this expression has this value. Then to take the grand ensemble average, it is less than equal to 1. So here, in writing this inequality, we have only assumed realism. No input of non-invasive measurability has been made. Now, in the actual experiment of testing, you can divide the whole ensemble of runs in 3 sub-ensembles, where for each of these ensembles, you carry out temporally separated measurements for T1, T2. Each case you take the same initials. Then if you impose the condition of non-invasive measurability, then one gets the condition that the value of Q for any time T1 measurement is independent of whether any prior or subsequent measurement has been made on the system. For any set of runs, Q has a definite value and it is irrespective, that means, of the pair in which occur. And it does not depend or whether any prior or subsequent measurement has been made. So whether any prior measurement has been made, that means non-invasive measurability has been assumed, that the earlier measurement has no effect on the subsequent outcome. And subsequent measurement has been also assumed not to have effect. That means backward causation. This is sometimes referred to as the assumption of induction. Now, then you take the separate sub-ensemble average, and then because of this assumption of non-invasive measurability, we have been able to replace this grand ensemble average by this sub-ensemble average, because the other subsequent or the prior measurements have no effect. So you can as well as replace the ensemble average by those sub-ensemble average. Then you have this inequality of this form, where experimentally you can measure all these sub-ensemble averages. So this is an experimentally measurable quantity. This imposes a macrorealist constraint as a consequence of realism and non-invasive. Similarly, you can obtain this inequality, imposing the macrorealist constraint on the joint probability of outcomes. For example, T2, T3, whether it is outcome plus 1 or minus 1. So this is an inequality in terms of joint probabilities. Derived here, the notion of realism is assumed in terms of the existence of overall joint probability, corresponding to different combinations of outcomes of measurements. And the assumption of non-invasive measurability is that these probabilities are unaffected by measurement, so that you can do appropriate marginalization. So from the overall joint probability by appropriate marginalization, you can derive the observable probabilities. So this, but this is also macro realism essentially. And so this is also can be looked upon as an necessary condition of macro. And the other one is the no signaling in time. That is the measurement outcome statistics for any observable at any instant is independent of the measurement done earlier. So that means that this is, so suppose you consider the measurement at time T2 of the observable Q and of the probability of outcome plus one, then that outcome should remain such, is independent of whether or not an earlier measurement has been made at T1. Or in other words, you can write that single probability as a combination of these two, the joint probabilities, where you really can marginalize for Q1 plus 1 and minus 1. So this equality should hold good if this assumption is made. And so no signaling in time condition is formed, is in the form of an equality in contrast to the other necessary conditions. And now just to complete the prelude, I have to also explain the idea of negative result measurement, why it is important in ensuring non-invasive measurement. Suppose we consider a two-state system, then that's the idea of negative result measurement is basically that if there are two available states, you design the apparatus such that the apparatus is triggered only if the system is, say, in the state one, and not triggered when the now, suppose we have a set of runs considered in the negative or in the other conditions. Then you just post-select those runs for which the apparatus has not been treated. Then they will correspond to outcomes for which the other state was there, the untriggered state for that measuring apparatus. Then similarly, you consider a complementary measuring apparatus for which apparatus is triggered only for the other state, and you post-select the runs corresponding to the untriggered state. And then you can accumulate the steps. So in that way, you ensure that the statistics you are studying, in each statistics of joint measurements of those temporal sequence you are studying, in each case, the first measurement was always done in a way that the apparatus has not interacted with the system. So the no interaction. Now, if you take a realist viewpoint that the system was in one state or the other at all times, so if I had obtained a measurement outcome without interacting with the system, so that means, and then if I get the violation of the macro realist necessary condition, then I would have to allow for the possibility that somehow the state of the system must have been affected without the interaction. That seems difficult to accommodate within a realism. So if a necessary condition of macro realism is violated, satisfying the condition of negative result measurement, it becomes difficult to accommodate how this realism condition can be maintained within the notion of macro realism. This is an important point because you can. It is otherwise very difficult to test the notion of realism directly. So here it provides a trick that if you consider this sort of situation and do such temporal joint measurements, then you infer that since in this context, if you have maintained realist model and the system is in one state or the other, then how can the state of the system be disturbed due to non-interaction? So that means only those realist models will be allowed if one shows violation of macro realism, for which you can accommodate the possibility of a state in that realist model being even affected, even if you can obtain measurement outcome without interacting with the system. In fact, Bohm model is an example of such a model, and you have heard talks on Bohm model. So in the context of Bohm model, it is clear that Bohm model it does not satisfy the condition of macro realism, the notion of realism. In the sense that if the system has one or other available states, then in Bohm model, the system is not in one state or the other. It is in a superposition space, like in quantum theory. Because in Bohm model, the state is described by the quantum wave function, by the properties of the observable variables, like the dynamical variables. They are taken to have definite values independent of measure. So that is the peculiarity of Bohm model. And those kind of realist models are not ruled out if you show violation of macro realism through this type of span involving negative result measurement. So when we say that implementing negative result measurement, you are satisfying macro realism, that means in the context of the notion of realism defined in this, what we mean by macro. This is an important caveat, which is often not realized. And so that's why I want to make it clear. So, but leaving aside Bohm model, the other type of all realist models that we so far know, for those class of realist models, this macro realism notion works. So in that sense, it is a powerful study ruling out a wide class of realist models directly. Because if you implement negative result measurement, then non-invasive measurability can be argued as a natural corollary of emotional realism. So it is difficult to explain how measurement can be invasive in the negative result measurement in the context of such macro realist models. So that's the underlying motivation why experimentally people have been trying to achieve loophole-free implementation of this negative representation to enlarge the scope of this study. Otherwise, you can always use this study to certify non-justice. Again, I'm making this point clear because if you look at the literature in recent years, there has been a plethora of experiments on testing Leggett-Gar in all very respectable journals and all these for microsystems. All the studies are on microsystems. So you may wonder why all these studies on microsystems are so important. Because all these studies are important. Already we know they are non-classical. So if the study of violating Leggett-Gar is showing non-classical, there it can do a little more, show, restrict the class of realism, rule out realism as well, if this non-invasive measurability is implemented. So that's that enterprise. And of course, if you go to the macro domain, it's more interesting. So far, only there have been two experimental claims about implementing non-invasive measurability in an unambiguous way, but I will not go into these details. Now, in the first work, the motivation has been that, as I have already mentioned, that the original suggestion was the measurement imprecision determined the emergence of classicality, and it was argued that it is particularly relevant for higher dimensions. Then there have been studies showing that for unrestricted measurement accuracy, quantum violation persists for large scale, similarly for local realism. But what is interesting, recently arguments have been put forward to show, argue that if measurements are coarse-grained, then the classicality should emerge in the large scale limit. That is the famous paper by Kopfler. And similar contentions have been also made for entangled systems in the large dimension limit, arguing that quantum violation of local realism should disappear for coarse-grained measurements. So the idea of coarse-grained measurements has been now gaining currency as a possible candidate for explaining emergence of classicality out of quantum mechanics, independent of the role of decoherence. Now in that context, our motivation was that since there has been no study probing emergence of classicality for higher dimensions, by modeling coarse graining in a very general way, by varying ability of resolving eigenvalues and also including fuzziness of measurement, we employed this quantum violation of macro realism as a tool for studying whether non-classicality can be shown in the large spin limit, even for arbitrary coarse grain measurements and even by including fuzzy measurements. Since the time is short and I want to cover the second work, well, I'm skipping the details. So basically, the system is a spin chase system in a uniform magnetic field of magnitude zero. So that is the kind of Hamiltonian, well known. And then one calculates all those quantities of the Leggett-Gar inequality or Wigner's form or in the no signaling in time condition, which is written in this form, as you can realize. Then if one studies by modeling coarse graining measurement in a perfectly general. So what we mean by coarse graining is that the individual eigenvalues cannot be sharply distinguished. that each of the, unless they are sufficiently separate. So the idea is that if the measurement is very much coarse grained, then you cannot distinguish, since you cannot distinguish the different eigenlevels, the idea was that you club different eigenlevels together. So at best, suppose you can distinguish, you dichotomize the extreme case, that you can say n number of outcomes, club it as plus one, and the other n number of outcomes, you club it as minus one. Since you cannot distinguish between the individual eigenlevels, you just club the outcomes together, and your apparatus is such that it can only distinguish whether the eigenlevel belongs to this class or that, not to the individual detail structure of this. So that we mean by saying that different number of my measurement outcomes are clubbed into two groups. And then there can be asymmetry in this clubbing when the outcomes are not equal and so on. But whatever you do, the final conclusion was that. And also we make this study more general by assuming that if you club just this way, that is not perfect modeling of coarse grain. The boundary between these two classes is still sharp. So you make the individual levels also unsharp. So you invoke the formalism of unsharp measurement as well as this coarse graining model of clubbing the outcomes. So that is the main idea of simultaneously clubbing the different outcomes together and by invoking unsharp measurements, by making each measurement also fuzzy so that the boundary is also fuzzy. Then you capture in a general way the effect of coarse grain. This was not done in the Kofler claim paper or in the other studies so far. So this is what the study we did, and I'm skipping all the details. There are more. The POBM way of modeling unsharp measurement and so on. And then this table also I'm skipping. And also this. But the essence of the result is that what we mean by the unbiased is that when the number of outcomes in these two classes are not equal. When unbiased means they are equal, but some biasness means some number of outcomes are clubbed as plus one and some number are clubbed as minus one. These two numbers are not equal. That means there is some biasness in plus one. Now, to make perfect modeling of coarse graining, you make it fully unbiased. That means the number of outcomes in the groups are equal. So if you make this and make the measurement unsharp, then you find that even then, the classicality does not emerge within quantum mechanics. This is best illustrated through the quantum mechanical violation of no signal. So in this case, it turns out that Legendre is not able to capture non-classical this limit of perfectly modeled coarse grain measurements and in the limit of large scale. And only no signaling in time is best possible choice, followed by Legendre. But then the question is that still there is one form of coarse graining still left, that is the idea of coarse graining of measurement times, because we have considered measurement times to be exact. Recently, it has been suggested that measurement times coarse graining should be also taken into account. So that study needs to be completed, our study, together with coarse graining of measurement times. So measurement time coarse graining together with coarse graining of measurement outcomes, which we have done, whether macrorealism can still be violated. But here, the violation of macrorealism is for a signature of non-classicality, because we are not worrying about this a theoretical study and experimentally large spin systems in atom system in magnetic systems. Just technology is developing spin 10, spin 50 for this Fe and Mn molecules that have been engineered with masses 5,000 AMU and so on. So in future it may become important, and there how to implement non-invasive measurability would be a challenging question. Some ideas have been suggested. The idea is that this is mainly to certify non-classicality, worrying so much about perfect loophole-free implementation of negative results. Now, the other example that we have been recently studying, that is to achieve these twin objectives, but most importantly, in the realm of nano-objects of large mass. And this is an active experimental area that has emerged within this whole technology of of these newly engineered systems of, say, you have the trapped this feedback thermal nano objects, trapped nano objects within the mass range 10 to the power 6 to 10 to the power 9 a.m. Using which there is a potentiality of exhibiting non-classicality or quantum effects in the range which has not yet been explored, already so far. So, in the atomic interferometry of molecules. So, our system has that potential. And that here we can also do loophole free implementation of non-invasive measurability. And interesting enough, we use Schrodinger coherence state, and there's a possibility of showing non-classicality persisting up to the maximum. So, this is the harmonic oil, the system we have in mind is the levitating nano object trapped in laser fields generating harmonic well of set, frequency 10 to the power 6 hertz. And then, in that context, if you take the initial web packet of this one, this is the well known web packet, and then I'm skipping the mathematics. What is important, if you take the Schrodinger coherence state with the initial width of this form, then the probability density of the web packet Schrodinger coherence state, we know it is the unique embodiment of classicality within quantum description. Whose center follows classical dynamics, and the web packet is non-spreading, satisfies minimum uncertainty principles. So it provides the best possible classical description or quasi-classical description within the framework of quantum theory. It also emerges as a natural pointer space for the linear harmonic oscillator in the context of equations. So what is striking, then one can employ the study of the necessary condition of macrorealism like Legendre and show non-classicality of the Schrodinger coherence. This is one significant feature. And this, and here the key parameters are the violation. By C, we mean the C is the right-hand side of the Legendre inequality. And the C is 2. The bound is 2. So you can see that for masses of the range of, say, 10 to the power 6 atomic mass unit, which is the relevant mass for the optical element and object, and then the classical amplitude is of the order of nanometer, and the initial peak momentum corresponds to the velocity of this. So the idea is that if you fix the mass, then by appropriately choosing the initial peak momentum, and the oscillator frequency is also fixed at 10 to the power 6, then suppose our interest is this mass range, 10 to the power 6 atomic mass range, then you can see that the violation instead of 2, the bound is 2. So you get a significant violation. The classical amplitude is of the order of micrometer, and the initial peak momentum is, say, 2 meter per second. Corresponds to this image. So you get a violation significant. And what is interesting is that if you compare the calculational results with that using three term LGI or WLGI or NSIP, the other necessary conditions for a given mass, the values, because here the values, crucial values are the initial value for the peak momentum, for the velocity corresponding to the peak momentum and the classical amplitude. So these are more or less optimal using four-term LGI. So you do not have any significant advantage over it by using NSIP or other forms. And also, what is important is that, so this emphasizes that which necessary condition of macrorealism you will use, it depends on the experimental context. For example, in this very recent experiment, NSIP was proved to be more effective in showing the non-classical for the low visibility of measure. And now, the setup we proposed is a nano object of, say, mass 10 to the power 6 atomic mass. And this is the idea we are discussing with Henrik and some of the inputs we have got from him. So, this is the feasibility study of the setup we have been doing. And here, the importance of the setup is that this here, the damping and decoherence effects are negligible because the time scale involved is of the order of 10 to the power minus 6 seconds, where the typical decoherence time is of this order. And what is most important, as Hendrik has already done, and his collaborators, pioneering experiments, the positions of these optically levitated masses can be observed with extremely high spatial resolution by this interferometric detection of light. So you can detect positions of these masses with some angstrom resolution. And while the detecting time window is very small compared to achieve much smaller than the time scale of oscillation. So the measurements can be regarded as instant, which is crucial for this for the temporal separation, correlation measurements, or joint probability measurements. And about the the negative result measurement, because here you have to only determine which of the wells the part of the oscillator is in. So you shine the light through one of the halves. If it doesn't interact, then you say, oh, haha, the object must be in the other. So that you can achieve by crisscrossing this one domain of the wall with the scattering light fields. And if the nano object fails to scatter light, then the state is projected in the eigenstate of its localization in the other half. So here, obtaining that outcome will not have any interaction. So the condition of non-invasive measurability is satisfied. So here, by showing violation of, and also another point is that the imprecision would lie in differentiating the presence of the object in this half or on the other half. So that imprecision, we have calculated the robustness of implementing this differentiation. That is very crucial, because whether the boundary between these two halves, so near the boundary there, the imprecision, how critical it is for effecting the violation of, say, Leggett curve. So it turns out that this imprecision or robustness turns out to be of the same order of the initial width of the wave packet, and our classical amplitude is larger than the initial wave packet. And that is more or less the same for all these measurements. That means we do not gain any significant advantages in other necessary conditions. So that's why it seems a very hopeful proposal. And so for a convincing realization of negative result measurement. And importantly, apart from it, it's not the micro domain. It can be scaled up to these large masses of optically levitated nanoobjects. So that would be a significant thing to show violation of this wide class of realist models at that mass range, apart from showing non-classicality. Okay. But what I'm emphasizing, this study as another spin-off, apart from showing non-classicality, it rules out, provides constraints on an alternative world. So to conclude, it is the empirical testing of macrorealism with increasing rigor using various necessary conditions, which I hope I've been able to convince you their relative efficacy depends on the experimental context. And apart from providing powerful tests of non-classical, it complements, that is the point I'm coming back as I begin by emphasizing the difference of local realism, that it complements the study of quantum incompatibility by providing greater constraints on the various possible realism models. Thank you.
So maybe one question.
Some systems that are not macro-realist. I'm thinking now to NMR systems where you have a huge assembly of spins. Do you consider that they are macro-realist systems? Can you show that?
By macro-realist, what do you
mean? According to all your criteria.
Entire experiments have been done with NMR showing violation of Leggett curve. But they're the non-invasive measurability. In fact, experiments testing Leggett-Clark inequality in microsystems have been done for a variety of systems, solid-state qubits, nuclear spins, NMR spins, electron spins, atoms hopping in a lattice for cesium atoms. Now, what that I emphasize, one may wonder, and most of them all are PRL or nature communication. So why it is important? Why people are doing it? obvious question. This is all non-classical, not merely non-classical, to rule out this other realist, macro realist. Unfortunately, among all those experiments, only those two experiments I mentioned, they are till to date the most, the closest realizations of negative result measurement in a loophole. So, like the Bell experimental case.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah.